RuneScape Lore presents Stray Shadow, Oh Shit, Wrong Side of Heaven. Written by Dustin Tigner. Read for you by Qarie Marshall. Recap. Story. The story thus far. Dhane, our fledgling protagonist, thrust into a heaven dedicated to gamers of all sorts, has just escaped Saratri City and the Redditi, Priests of Light. They hunt him because of the corruption in his soul, for he is of both light and shadow, an anomaly that threatens the very foundation, the very philosophy, that gives the changed Redditi their power. Before escaping the city with Devron and a handful of Kobolins, he destroyed the city's one and only cemetery of shadow. In death, the Kobolins can now escape and finally be free. Sadly, their home, deep beneath Saratri in hidden caves, once protected by the Volanti Sepairi Mahai, has been destroyed. To give them a new home, Dhane uses a legendary village seed and has taken on the solemn responsibility as the leader of Dedu Tedu Novus. Moments after the village's creation, however, seven declarations of war were made, sending beams of red light skyward over the various towns and cities, and locking all local waypoint stones. Gamius, god of the realm, desperate for entertainment in what he considers a boring world, now full of nerds, appeared before Dhane. The god looked the other way while Pip, the god's red imp assistant, handed over a rare leather-bound notebook containing sophisticated notes on magical symbol theory. With that, Dhane and his new village were left to fend for themselves, now in possession of knowledge that might just save them in the war to come. For recap characters, bunch of oddballs, and character sheet, please refer to the bonus PDF included with this audiobook. Chapter 1. Back in university, Evan, geek coder extraordinaire, tried to show Dhane how programming languages worked. The delighted man spoke of functional programming, recursion, and really it could have been black hole theory for as far as Dhane was concerned. But despite the mind-twisting ideas of bits of code recursively calling themselves or delegates or event handling, the core idea was to communicate intent. Communication was something Dhane was very good at, programming less so. Unfortunately, magic symbols fell within the arcane logic of conditionals, loops, and variables. Magic was programming, yet it was also a language. He may not understand algorithm efficiency and its big O notation, but all the different symbols amounted to an alphabet with words and intent, and it took very little time to pick through those symbols and come up with new ideas. However, such things had to wait. The warm night, glowing from torchlight and a bright silver moon, was filled with a chorus of terror-filled screams. Terror and laughter. An odd combination, to be sure. "And throw!" the Kobolins yelled together, a chant of grating voices. These voices were directed at a small, wide-eyed Kobolin who had just shifted out from the empty void of death to appear upon one of the four slabs in Dedu Tedu Novus's cemetery of light and shadow. The newly returned Kobolin, and slave stone still chained to her ankle, was launched into the air. She twisted and turned, screaming a shrill sound before landing in the center fountain next to the dozen others who had recently completed their thrilling, wet remittance to the world. Other Kobolins, the ones not rolling on the ground laughing, helped pull the flailing returned Kobolins from the water before they got clobbered by the next round of artillery fire. This all went to show that though all the Kobolins looked quite similar, short and green with large ears and expressive dark eyes, there was an entire spectrum of maturity levels. Some took action to help while others laughed and played, a new light in their souls for finally being free. Slab 2 and 4, Dhane yelled at the exhausted Koppelins, giving them a break and ushering the next team to take their places. If the slabs were not immediately evacuated before the next Koppelin decided to return, they'd either encounter a freak accident, the first two-headed Koppelin, anyone? Or more likely the case, the poor Koppelin would return in a different cemetery altogether, lost, alone, and forever far away. No one questioned Dane's authority, not with him being human and aligned to the shadow affinity. They saw him as the King of Shadows. When he fabricated the King of Shadows, it was purely in hope of staying relevant and interesting to society so he wouldn't get thrown away to the Priests of Light. It was never meant to be real. It wasn't real. But that wasn't the only thing the Koppelins called him. He was the leader of Dedu Tedu Novus, Hopebringer, and the one who freed them. Such things went a long way in convincing even the most stubborn and defiant of the lot to fall in line. "It's gonna be fine," Devron said to a timid Koppelin, holding the metal shackle that wrapped the tiny guy's ankle. "I'm gonna blast it right off your foot."
No, it's fine," the Koppelin said.
He had ragged black hair and eyebrows doing their best to sever themselves and crawl away.
"I like chain. Yes, I do. Pretty chain. Very pretty."
"That's nonsense," Devron said, and winked at Dhane as if to say, "Watch me do something awesome." "This won't hurt a bit, little man. Just gotta hold real still, all right?" The Koppelin grimaced and swallowed hard. He nodded weakly and stared at the swirl of glowing white liquid that formed into a sphere within Devron's hand. Devron thrust his hand forward, and the magical ball of energy slammed against the Koppelin's foot. It disintegrated instantly. There was a fraction of a second where both the Koppelin and Devron stared at the spot where, once upon a time, there had been a foot. Then the Koppelin howled in pain, kicking his legs. Devron jerked upright, screeching in an uncharacteristically high-pitched voice,
"Oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, shit!"
He patted the Koppelin's footless leg, as if doing so would magically resummon the foot he had so excitedly blasted apart. 3 seconds later, the Koppelin stopped thrashing and noticed his chain had fallen off. His eyes were round, his mouth hung open. He shoved away and hopped on his remaining foot, dragging his slave stone by the chain to where Kubi and a few others were stacking the stones in some sort of monument.
"That man!"
the Koppelin yelled, pointing an accusatory finger at Devron, who stared in abject horror. The Koppelin drew the attention of dozens of the green people.
"That one, big one, black one, he blew off my foot. Look, it's gone, gone, gone."
"Oh, man," Devron shook his head. "That's not what I was trying to do." He held his arms out, palms up in a begging manner, as if his words alone wouldn't convey the truth of his sincere intent. He started saying something else, but then tensed. The Koppelin hopped back toward him, waving a finger to ensure no one could misinterpret who the Koppelin was talking about. At less than a foot away, he grinned and planted a slobbery kiss on Devron's conflicted forehead.
"He freed me," the Koppelin said. "Thank you, big man."
And with that, he returned to the others, who pointed at his missing foot and laughed. "I think," Dhane said, "you've earned a new title." Devron arched an eyebrow. "The Slayer of Feet? No way, man. That's terrible. I didn't want to blow off his foot." "Well, you know, the others found chisels in the tool shed."
"That's so mundane." "Hey," he snapped his fingers, "what about a magic symbol? There's gotta be a cool symbol to unlock locks, right?"
The question slithered into Dane's mind and joined all the other ideas currently fighting for attention. The short answer was yes. There was most definitely a way to use the magical symbols to pick locks. Doing so, however, required understanding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.